I'll have two units. One is teacher professional development, another is evaluation and assessment. I'll handle two topics. So first, we'll complete first three days. We'll talk about teacher professional development. And later, we'll have two sessions on evaluation and assessment. So let's begin our session. So first, let's see the objectives, the main objectives of... So here we'll learn three things. One is called concept, needs, means of teacher professional development. And then these are the three things we'll normally talk about on online profession, because online we don't have many sessions because you join only for 2 hours. So in face-to-face we have many sessions, but here in three sessions we'll try to complete all of the points that we talk about. So let's quickly have a look at the objectives. What is the objectives of this teacher professional development? Why have we incorporated this in this CLT program? So first thing is that we want to develop your observation skills. And because those who are good observers, they are good learners, right? You agree with me? You can type in the chat box. Don't unmute your mic.
Yes, sir. Chat box.
Type in the chat box. All right. Don't raise your hands, please. All right. Raise hand off. Yes, safe. All right. Don't raise your hands. Okay. So, right. So the good observers are good learners, and good learners are yes, very good. That will do. Okay. So good observers are good learners, and good learners can also become good teacher. All right. Agree with me? Good learners can become good teachers.
Yes, sir.
Don't unmute. Type in the chat box. Don't answer in, you know. Type in the chat box, okay? Because I want you to learn how to type in the chat box also. That is another technology skill, all right? Especially in online sessions, we always use chat box. Because if more than one person unmute mic, then voice quality get distracted. So that's why. So that is what our first objective of this teacher professional development is, to develop your observation skills. You not only observe the members of the faculty, RISI faculty members, you should also observe other peoples, your own fellow participants from other states, okay? The, you know, how teachers from Kerala respond, react, okay, act, how teachers from Karnataka respond, act, react, how teachers from Andhra, Telangana, respond, act, react, okay? So you need to observe each and every one, okay? So once you start observing others, you unknowingly get modified. Modified means unknowingly you go and undergo some sort of changes, okay? So just imagine this is, I think, sixth day. You already attended 1 week program. So you imagine yourself the day one, when you are confused how to do, how to not to do, what to do, what not to do. But today you are quite comfortable. You know almost everything. How to join, how to log in, how to answer, how to mute the mic, how to unmute the mic, how to unmute, on the camera, how to off the camera. You already know. So in the meantime, you have undergone a lot of changes. That is, you have got modified. All right. So that is, once you start observing, you automatically, unknowingly modify yourself. And that is another crucial point in your professional life. So modification is necessary. Physically, you undergo a lot of modifications, whether you like it or not. But when you need mental modification, you need to intentionally undergo some sort of changes. That is important, especially in our teaching profession. If you really want to modify yourself to a better teacher, to a successful teacher, that you need to intentionally modify yourself. Give up all the old habits, okay, and adapt new things, and that is what is called modification. Physically, you will undergo modification without your knowledge or whether you like it or not, but a mental modification can be achieved by taking, planning a special program and undergo some sort of modification intentionally with hard work, okay? So that is, once you undergo modification, you become independent learners, called autonomous learner, means independent learners. You don't need to depend on others. You know how to do, what to do, what not to do, and how to do certain things successfully without wasting much time. So that is what you become, independent learners, autonomous learners. And once you become autonomous learners, you tend to look at your own needs. So this area I am very good. Teaching, no problem. But what about English? So sometimes when we see, as a teacher, you don't need any training. But so far as English language teaching is concerned, we still need to improve our language. We still need to improve our pedagogy and all these things. So that is what we need to look at our needs. So what is the needs present at the moment? That as a teacher, you are quite successful because of your experience, okay, hard work, planning. But so far as English is concerned, even though you have a lot of English, but still there is scope for improvement. Now, if you really want to improve your English, what do you do? Sit idly doing nothing? No. That way you cannot develop, you know, your language proficiency. You need to spare some time. Plan every day for 1 hour or half an hour, whatever time is available. I'll be spending learning English. Or whatever English I have learned, I'll be refining it. So that you need to plan. And that is another call, locating needs and working on that. And as you start doing this thing, what happens, you acquire new skills. That new skill can be gathered only by doing new things. I heard somewhere that doing same thing and expecting different results, that is called insanity, madness. Some people want to become very fluent in English, but they never speak English, they will never read English books. That you cannot accept. So if you really want to become very successful, you know, very fluent speakers, okay, then you'll have to spend some time on it. Maybe time may be 15 minutes, 1 hour, half an hour or 1 hour, but on daily basis. Like we have breakfast, lunch and dinner every day. So professional growth is also kind of that kind of routine life. Okay, you'll have to follow that particular routine. All right, so then you can acquire new skills. But don't do the same thing. If you really want something else, do something else. And that is most important. How do you do? We design different activities. Sorry. What are the activities can we do? We can prepare different classroom activities for teaching the textbook. All right. So you see, if you're handling class 9, you're all handling 8 to class 10, right? Can you type in the chat box? 8 to 10, right? Right. So, okay, fine. That will do. Now, if you are handling class 9, you have only one textbook, right? Yes or no? So, if you are handling class 9, SS, for example, Andhra Pradesh. So, the textbook is used throughout Andhra Pradesh. And Andhra Pradesh is not a small place. It's a big place. All right? But you have one single textbook. You look at Srikakulam district. Srikakulam is completely different from Vijayanagaram. Vijayanagaram is completely different from Vishakhapatnam. Vishakhapatnam is different from East Godavari. East Godavari from different from West Godavari. West Godavari different from Krishna. Krishna is different from Guntur. Guntur is different from Prakasham. Prakasham is different from Kadapa. Kadapa is different from Chittur. Chittur is different from Nellore. All right. Nellore is different from Prakasham. So you see, you have the same textbook. But, you know, look at the situation in Andhra Pradesh. Probably you have not gone to all the places I have been to. So I know. All right. So, but you have the same textbook. But look at the condition, Sildian, comprehension level of the learners. Are the same? No, it's not the same. Now, how do you do that? And for many of your places, okay, especially you go to Kakinara area, the textbook is very difficult for them. The text lessons, the activities given in the textbook is different. Now, how do you know correct it? So, how do you help your learners to read this? Probably design different activities. All right. Take the activity and the lesson, see whether your children can read it or not on their own. If they cannot, you may have to simplify it. If it is 4 pages lesson, you reduce it. All right. Something like this. All right. You look at the exercises given at the end of the lesson. If the exercises are difficult, simplify them, keeping the same objectives in mind. Right? So something like this. You look at in Kerala, the same thing in Telangana, in Karnataka, from Bidar to, you know, Chamarajanagar, it's a huge area. You have the same textbook. Huh? Yeah, from, if you go to, you know, Kasargod to Trivandrum, it's a huge area, stress of land. You have the same textbook. Kasargod is different from, you know, Kozhikode. Kozhikode is different from Kannur. Kannur is different from Malappuram. All right? Malappuram is different from Palakkad. Palakkad is different from Thrissur. All right. So go down, you know. You see, you know, this textbook remains the same, but situation varies. Now, how do you do that? So you need to design activities for classroom practices. And that is once you start doing, you know, writing, designing new activities, what happens? You keep in touch with the language, sharpen, harness your skills. Harness your language, harness skills, thinking skills and preparing skills, okay? So that is, and once you do that, you know, all right, same happens with Adilabad to, you know, Nagar Karnool, okay? To hear, Khammam to, you know, Kodagudem. You go to this site, Kamareddy, okay? Rangareddy. It's completely huge area, but you have the same textbook, okay? Nalgunda is different from Siddipet. Siddipet is different from Khammam. Mehbub Nagar is different from Mehbubabad. So, but you have the same textbook, same lessons. Okay? So that is what I'm saying. Once you read your students, their comprehension levels, and start designing, redesigning the textbook activities, all right? Modifying the textbook lessons, simplifying it if it is very difficult. Okay, making it challenging if it is very easy for some of this, you know, Matsal or Hyderabad area reasons. Okay, so you modify it, make it a little challenging because children are quite advanced. So that is how we harness and surface our skills. And once you do that, what happens? You develop confidence that I have prepared this kind of activities and these activities are successful in my classroom. So you develop confidence. You know how to do, what not to do, how to do, how to do it very successfully. And that is how. So we have this couple of objectives. So we'll try to realize. You try to realize all of these objectives or some of these objectives. Okay? So something like this. Okay. So that's what, you know, done. Now we'll talk about this framework. So I have read a book called A Methodology in Language Teaching on an Anthology of Current Practice by J.C. Richard and W.A. Renandia. So this is the latest book. And while writing this book in 2002, these two writers also quoted another two writers called Hargit and Phulams, who wrote their book in 1992. And they quoted this line because this line is very important. And Hargit and Phulams says, the teacher is the ultimate key to educational change and school improvement. So if you really want to change, you know, your school, your, you know, system, education system, then it is in your hand. I remember some of the teachers, our old friend, you know, especially in Tamil Nadu. There are two teachers, I always take their name. Now I think they are high school. One is Dilip Razu teacher in the Bilupuram district. Okay, another is this. Her name is Mohan. What is her name? Called Mohan. Her name is Now, first, let me talk about Dilip Razu sir. He is so expert in technology. All right, he's a super duper in technology, and he has made a lot of changes in schools and the whole department, education department of Tamil Nadu. They take his assistance in conducting even program for their teacher training. All right, and now NCERT has asked him to conduct many such online programs for them also. All right. So that is what is important. Another teacher, her name is, Mohan. She was our former participant, ex-participant, primary school teacher. She last day she said, sir, I want to do something. So God bless him. Went there and then made her government primary schools, ordinary primary schools, a smart classroom on her own. And now that whole department recognizes her for her contribution to the education system. So that is what that teacher can do, a lot of things. What education minister, education secretary may not be able to do certain things, but teacher, an ordinary teacher somewhere in rural areas, teaching in Warangal, somewhere Warangal, rural, all right, or Siddipet, all right, or Bhubanapalli, all right, they can do a lot of things. Right? Only thing you need to have some ashakti, interest, that I want to do something. That is what is very important. So teachers do not simply implement the curriculum, and they do not simply define and refine curriculum, but they interpret in such a way the learning become manageable for the learners. Right? Today what happens, your learners find it quite difficult to manage their learning. Because you see, you teach one subject. How many subjects do you teach? Can you type in the chat box? How many subjects do you teach every day? Not period, subject. Can you type? One subject, very good. Can I sir say one only? Okay. Yes, one. Charnalata says one. One of English and ICT, okay, one. Ambati Ram say one, okay. Somebody Tirupati Rao says two. Janardhan MG say one. Venkata Sharma one. Susitra one. Three, huh? Okay, Anuradha, this is three subject. Three subject or three period? One second. Hello, sir. Right, so Srilata teaches two subjects, very good. Sapna teaches one subject, very good. Okay, this will do. Yeah. English, science, and ICT, okay. Right, okay. 4 to 5 period. I'm not talking of period, subjects. Right. Right, now, yes. Now look at this, you teach one subject, maximum, majority of you teach one subject, one or two teachers two subject, all right? Otherwise most of you teach only English. But look at your own student, class 8 student, all right? Chenchaya in Telangana, all right? Nasima in Andhra Pradesh, Krishnan in Kerala, all right? And Madhesha in Karnataka. How many subjects do they teach? Do they learn every day? All right? 6, 7 subjects. Now you as an English teacher, you go and teach one English lesson, give one homework. Your mother tongue teacher goes there, teaches one lesson in Kannada, Malayalam, Telugu, and Tamil, and gives another homework. Science teacher teaches one topic and gives another homework. All right. Maths teacher goes, completes one sum, gives three sums for us as homework. Like this, social science teacher teaches one lesson, give another homework. So at the end of the day, how many subjects your student learns? Class student, okay? Six subjects, okay? All right. So before they complete their assignments, next day again, they repeat the same, okay? Six, seven subjects every day. And then before they complete the homework, and there is nobody at home to help them, all right? And you don't help in the classroom to complete the homework. So as a result, their learning become heavier and heavier and heavier and heavier. And as a result, you see your student, Madesha, Kishnan, Nasima, Chanchaya, okay? They are at the beginning of the session and at the end of the session, he's there, all right? Right. So that is what, you know, that is what we need to understand. Now you put your legs into Lana's shoes and try to see if I were the student of class 8 and teacher is giving assignment after assignments, do you think I would have been able to complete this task? And that is what we need to understand, ladies and gentlemen. All right. So it is what, hence it is what you think and you do. That ultimately determines what your learners learn. So that is the framework that we talk about. All right? So whatever we are going to do, we'll keep this in mind, that learning is unmanageable for learners and my role as a teacher is to help them manage their learning. All right? And I'll do those activities, those things that enable learners to manage their learning. Okay? So that is. So now let's quickly have a look at. Now let's quickly have, you know, this question. I have three questions. Number one, what do you mean by development? Can you somebody type in the chat box in one word or one phrase? Okay, what do you mean by development? Can you quickly type? Improvement, very good. Mary Celine, says improvement. Onof Anthony says positive change, very good. Yes. Chansaya says continuous progress, okay. Change in behavior, Sharnalata. Anuradha says better behavior, okay. Better sense, okay. Progressive progression, okay. Kalaivani says growth. Kalaivani from which state? Tamil Nadu people are not there. Pondicherry, are you from Kalaivani? You're from which state, Kalaivani?
I'm from Puducherry, sir.
Puducherry, yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. How many of you are there from Puducherry?
From Puducherry, four of us have joined, sir. Okay, and Mahi and Kerala, two or four more are there.
Total eight from Bondi.
Eight.
Okay. No teachers from Tamil Nadu, sir, in this training.
This year they are not coming. This year they are not coming. There are some problem. So next program they will join. Right. So good. Very good. So you have many answers. Okay. I have one question. So you have many answers. So that's what we say. Now stop typing. That's why we say that if you have every question has got two answers. One is called right answer. One is called wrong answer. And if you have more than two answers, that means our understanding is not clear, vague, okay? Sometimes when we do not know the correct answer, we give more than one series of answers, okay? If not this, it should be this. If not this, it should be this. So that is, idea. When our idea is not transparent or when idea is vague, then we give more than one answers, okay? Something like this, okay? Very good, okay? We'll switch over to the next question. Next question is, what do you mean by development? Okay. Now, next question is, it's not moving. Okay. The question is, why do we need to develop? But I want to ask you, how many of you need to develop? How many of you think that you need to develop? Can you type in the chat box? Okay. Vivisha Josh says me. Okay. Very good. Okay. You need development. Mamta says, I need, okay, very good. Onum Anthony says, myself, okay. Tirupati Rao says, me, okay. Shiva Prashad says, Sansaya says, okay. Puttaraju says, okay. Shapna says, okay. Mahalakshmi says, Vaikasri says, Arjunan says, okay, Geeta Lata says, Venugopal says, Surya. That will do. Okay, all of you need some, all of you need development. But my question is, why do we need to develop? Look at the questions here. Why do we need to develop? Yes, I understand. All of you need some sort of development. But my question is, why do we need development? Why do we need to develop? Okay. Adam Shafi says, to improve my personality, okay? Okay. To live happily, okay? To better, okay. To attain my goal. Very good. Positive changes, okay. All right, good. To survive. This is correct answer. To survive. Who said this? To survive? Prabhasis, to survive. Very correct answer, Prabha. I'm happy that you have come with my answer that I wanted to ask here. Very good. Well done. Okay, stop typing.
Well done. Okay, stop typing. Thank you, sir.
All of you have some philosophical answers, okay? But Prabha has got the right answer. We need to survive first. Once you survive, you can live happily, all right? But if you cannot survive, living happily, it doesn't arise, okay? That question doesn't arise. Very good. We need to survive first. You see, look at one thing I would like to tell you. We are all 20th century teachers. We are born in 20th century, got our education in 20th century, became teacher in 20th century. Till 2000, all right, it was 20th century. After 2000, it is called 21st century. Now we, all of you, me, all right, including me, we are born in 20th century. We got education in 20th century. We became teacher in 20th century. But the children we are handling in the class now, they are 21st century learners. Last 20 years that we have been teaching, you are teaching 21st century learners. They are not 20th century learners. So this will have to make distinction. We are 20th century teacher, but we are handling 21st century learners. Now, if you are handling your 21st century learners, or teaching the 21st century learners, the way your teacher taught you in 20th century, you are taking these 21st century learners to 20th century back. What the mind there? If you are teaching your student the way you are taught during your school days, you are taking the 21st century learners back to 20th century. That is one thing that you need to understand. Aipenda? Right? Ortham Ainda? So that is one important. Yes, that is one thing we'll have to understand. For that is the reason we need to undergo change. We need to develop ourselves to become 21st century teachers. We are still 20th century teacher. Mentally, thought process, everything 20th century teacher. But we are handling 21st century learners. Now, we need to make ourselves 21st century teachers. Only then we are eligible to teach our 21st century students. Otherwise, children will not listen to you, because most of your children, know much more than what you and me, we know. All right? So that is one thing you'll have to understand, that we are all 20th century teachers. We are born in 20th century, got education in 20th century, became teacher in 20th century. But the children we are handling today are 21st century. So my goal is to make myself 21st century. So whatever 21st century skills that I have not yet learned, I need to learn them. Then only I'll be eligible to become a 21st century teacher and handle 21st century learners. For that reasons, we need to develop. The question of survival. And you must have noticed last 2 years, because of COVID-19, many teachers who are working in private schools, they lost their job. They lost their job. The private sector retain only those teachers who have some 21st century skill, like conducting, ability to conduct online classes, okay, computer skills or technology skills. They are still working. But those teachers who, you know, didn't know all these things, they used to teach, you know, face-to-face like this, the way we were taught traditionally. They lost their job. They lost their job. We do not realize this because we are in government sector. We get our salary, we don't understand. But private sector school teachers, many, many lost their job. So we don't know what happens next. All right. So for that reasons, we need to acquire those skills which will be needed another 5 years to come, another 10 years to come. For that reasons, we need to undergo a lot of changes. Understand, okay, develop, have mastery over some 21st century skills. And that is what is important. All right. Otherwise, we don't know what will happen tomorrow. And you should be ready to, you know, do anything. Okay. Why do we need change? Now look at this. What do you see here in this image? Can you type in the chat box? What do you see? What does this image signify? What does this symbol, you know, say? Very good. Yeah. Patalanka, you know. Patalanka, Chakravarti says brain. Yes, this is a brain. Human brain. Thank you.
So it is the image of the human brain.
Yes, very good. This is a brain. And okay, that will do. You know, stop typing. Yes, stop typing. It's a brain, human brain. Yeah. And you all know that you have your own brain. Sometimes people forget that they have brain because problem after problem, problem at home, problem in the school, problem with the headmaster, problem with the children. Sometimes you forget that we have a brain. And when your hospital, some doctor says there is something wrong in the brain, then we realize, I have a brain, huh? All right. You see, human brain is very powerful. But it is the laziest part of our body, all right? You must have seen people traveling in city buses. Some people get sick, some people don't get sick. And those who get sick, they sleep on others. And those who do not get sick, they hold on the rod and then keep, you know, the moment the bus, you know, please, switch off your camera, sir. Yeah. And when you hold on the bus, okay, the rod, and the moment bus moves and then you feel sleepy. Am I right? You see, your hands is working, body is working, but you feel sleepy. All right? So that means that our brain is the laziest part of our body. Huh? And sometimes people sleep in the classroom also. Huh? Especially in online classroom, because teacher doesn't see where is that student sitting. Okay, they sleep sometimes. All right. One day I realized, you know, by mistake, his camera was on, and he didn't realize, and he's sleeping on the bed, putting legs on the wall, and then attending my class. I said, "What is this?" Okay, something like this. So people sleep. Sometimes they online attend marbeku, all right? Martivi attendance irutte illi join marbeku sleep martare. Especially 2 to 3 sessions, people sleep sometimes after uta agmele. All right. Now I'm not talking of you because now you are in duty. So from school probably you are attending the session. From school or home? You are attending this home, then you might be, there is a possibility of sleeping. Okay, good. Okay, good. Right, but don't sleep. Okay, don't worry.
So since you are driving, so you are not in my school.
Good, good, good.
In my school. So,
yes. Okay. So yeah. So this is brain. So human brain is very powerful, but it is the laziest part of our body. It is something like car engine or bike engine. See, if you are riding a bike, its minimum power of the engine is 100 cc. That means super duper powerful. All right. Your engine is 100 cc means super duper powerful engine. And if you are driving a car, minimum car engine is 800 cc means super duper. But car and bike doesn't move on their own. You need to put the ignition key switches on and put in gear, then only car moves. All right. Our human brain has the similar capacity. Unless you switch on your brain and put in gear, your brain doesn't work. All right. So that's why, you know, it is like car engine. It's very powerful, but it doesn't move on your own. You need to intentionally switch it on and put in gear. And then only it becomes active, very powerful. All right. So from now onward, from today onward, switch on your brain and never, ever, never, ever switch up it off. All right. Switch it off. Never switch up till the last day of your professional life. All right. When you retire, then you switch up. You don't need to think. But till then, all right, keep it in on mode. Okay. Not sleep mode, on mode. Okay. So then another 3 months to come, you will see the power of your brain. It can crash any heart knot. It's so powerful. It's so powerful. And you will be able to solve any problem you face in your personal life, in your professional life, because your brain will work for you. And it's so tremendous power it has got. Okay. It will take you anywhere that you wish to move. All right. That is the power of your brain. Use it, ladies and gentlemen. Use it. All right. Don't waste the power that you have got. All right. If have nobody have to, has told you so far, I'm telling you now, you have tremendous power in your brain. Just utilize it. Switch it on and you will see. If you have any problem today and you go, while going to bed, you tell your brain, I have this problem. By the time I get up tomorrow morning, I need three solutions. And the moment you get up tomorrow morning, you will see idea will come and take hold on that idea and work on that. Your problem will be sorted out. That's the power of your brain. Your brain will work like a slave for you. All right. All right. When you sleep, your brain in semi-conscious mind, it will work for your problem and find out the solution. So switch it on and never switch it. And as you switch on your brain, open your brain. Open means don't cut and open. Open means listen to each and everyone. Listen to a highly educated people. Listen to ordinary village farmer. Okay, they may not have that high education, but they have experience. They, without even looking at the weather, they can tell you this year going to be heavy rain. This year going to be flood. This year going to be very drought or something like that. They have certain experience. So listen to those people also. Listen to ordinary students sitting at the back, cannot read, cannot differentiate between B and D in class 8 also. Listen to those children. Listen to highly qualified people. Listen to ordinary people. Listen to elderly people. Listen to your senior. Listen to your juniors. Seniors have experience. Juniors have ideas. You need both. Okay. Listen to your own kid, a small kid at home. They don't speak sense. But if you keep listening to whatever nonsense they speak today, in your eyes, this small kid will become this big and they will continue to speak sense with you. All right. So open your brain and listen. We have 2 ears to listen, only one mouth to speak. Listen more, as much as possible. All right. And especially listen to English to become a successful English teacher. Listen. These days, in our days, when we started our profession, there was no such facilities called mobile or audio, video, YouTube, Google, no, nothing was. We had to depend only on physical library. But today, if you want to listen English, here you type conference audio. All different conferences conducted so far in the universe, all will come here. You select one and listen, keep listening to. Instead of, you know, listening to song, Kannada karallige hambalisidhe mana, listen to English. You listen to English. Right? That is what you can, you know, easily, you know, you know, learn. You have English teacher with you in your mobile. All right. You have all a smart mobile. Now you need to become smart to use your smart mobile. Okay. Right. Now, as you open your brain, you need to, you know, listen to your heart. Now, heart is very important. All right. So I read somewhere, you know, that in circus earlier, one person used to walk on the rope. Earlier in circus, with a small stick, hold on, and walk on the rope. All right. But today in Tamil Nadu, go anywhere, you will see a small kid also walk on the rope. Okay, that's different. But then in circus, one person who, that joker type, you know, one person walks on the rope, and that person was interviewed. Sir, tell me how you maintain your balance while walking on the rope. That person said, no, I don't walk on the rope. When I stand in a particular pole, I throw my heart into other pole and my body follows my heart. All right. So that is important. In our profession, teaching profession, you need to throw your heart to your class, your profession, and your body will automatically follow it. All right. And that is, you know, this important. Your brain will get tired after some time, but heart will never get tired. If you put your profession in your heart, then you will never feel tired. You will walk extra miles and you will work hard. And because of your hard work, extra mile, you will become an extraordinary teacher and whole department will recognize it. All right? And that is what is necessary. And you will relish, you will enjoy your profession. Otherwise, profession itself is a burden. You are working because of the salary you are getting. That is, salary will come automatically. But you should enjoy. You should, you know, develop what is called plausibility. You should be relishing your class when you do that. And once you do that, all right, you are successful. Because you have thrown your heart into your profession. And the heart takes wherever you want to go. All right. So, ladies and gentlemen, what I'm trying to talk about with all these things is actually, I will skip some of these things, okay? We'll talk about this later. I would like to tell you that the definition of professional development. Can somebody read this for me quickly? Can somebody read this, what I have written here?
Professional development is a process, not continual. No, one person, Mary G
will read this for me. Mary.
Yes. Professional development is a process of continual intellectual, experimental, and attitudinal growth of teachers.
Experiential. Read once again.
Experiential, yeah. Experiential and attitudinal growth of teachers. Written by Dale L. Land.
Very good, Mary. Thank you very much. Okay. So this is what I'm talking to you all this just to let you know that professional development is a process. Process of continual means continual and continuous. What is the difference? Continuous is without break. Continual is with break. So once you attend this 30-day CLT, next 6 months, you don't need to attend any other program. So break, with break. So continual, what? Intellectual means academic growth. And experiential, okay? Experiential means experience something new things. Do something new, experience new things. And change the attitude, all right? Attitude, will next time we'll talk about attitude. Attitude is a combination, different aspect, all right? Different aspect. It's a combination of how we think, how we'll talk about our thinking. Is attitude is a combination of your thinking, emotion, ways of viewing events and circumstances around, perspective, what our we actions that we take, what we do, and how we respond to things that happen in our life. This constitute attitude of a particular person. So this is when we talk about professional development, that is the attitudinal growth of this, that our attitude should be productive. Productive means it not only helps me, it helps the entire surrounding where I am there. Okay, something like that is what is called productive attitude. So finally, we came to know the definition of professional development. Professional development is a process. It is not product. Process, and process has begun, has already started from today, all right? And from now onward, you'll have to intentionally undergo some sort of intellectual or academic changes, all right? Progress, experiential progress. Do something new, learn something new. Don't repeat the same thing. And then it's the attitudinal growth. We have to change our, make our attitude productive. That it not only helps me, it helps the entire surrounding wherever I am. All right. So with this, ladies and gentlemen, we'll stop it here because I have one more session. Okay. So thank you very much. Nice talking to you guys. Okay. We'll meet you in my next session. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Beautiful. Fantastic.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. So I'll close the meeting.
Sir, super, sir.
Welcome, sir. Okay. We'll meet you next time. All right.